What is it that makes Metroid, Metroid? No, really, what would you say are those critical elements that make a Metroid game real? I think the answer, much like the series, is more complex than it seems. But no matter where you stood, the day that Metroid Prime was announced, one thing seemed beyond certain. This is not my Metroid! Seriously, Prime was treated with caution at best and blind rage at worst. Fans were worried, and you know what? They had every reason to be. Super Metroid came out in 1994. Now let's hammer that home. This was the newest game in the series for 8 years. And a lot had changed in 8 years. Nintendo's rivals were no longer scrappy fellow video game companies. They were global corporations with gaming divisions. Where in 1994, three-dimensional games were sort of swirling in this primordial soup, both graphically and mechanically, the industry had spent those 8 years trying to figure out how to make a game work in 3D. And the exploration-focused Metroid series seemed like such a natural fit, it was almost ridiculous that it had taken this long. So with so much anticipation, and so much riding on this, how could Nintendo relinquish Samus' long-awaited return to an outside company that had never so much as released a video game? All Retro Studios had ever accomplished was canceling titles and laying off its staff. How could they hope to possibly capture what made Metroid, Metroid? Definitely not by turning it into one of those filthy, casual, first-person shooters. Keep in mind, we were less than a decade out from Doom, and the FPS genre was still pretty much dominated by twitchy action games, especially on consoles. Nintendo could crow all they wanted about how, no, guys, this is a first-person adventure. But nothing they said could shake this collective worry that all of Metroid's subtleties would be brushed aside for some uninspired, formulaic hallway shooter. I bet some of you have never heard this part of the story before, of Metroid Prime's, troubled announcement. But the reason that that became a historical footnote is because, well, you do know how this story ends. Metroid Prime would turn out to be the most critically acclaimed game in the entire franchise. It was a killer app for the GameCube, hitting at the perfect time, when gamers were super worried that if we seemed too kiddy, nobody would take us seriously. Nintendo, with its stupid toy box console full of stupid cartoon games, was being torn apart for not being mature enough. Yet here was a title with depth and substance that Nintendo fans could use to silence those critics. Yeah, the industry was kind of going through this edgy adolescent phase. So, when an edgy adolescent named Josh headed to the old Blockbuster Video on November 17th, 2002, he had seen the hype, he had already read the reviews, and you better believe that he rented Metroid Prime. And also Animal Crossing. Look, I had already gotten a GameCube instead of a PS2. I could regularly be seen in public at the time, playing a fluorescent pink GBA. I was never going to be cool anyway. I still remember how it felt to see that stylized intro. God, even the menu of this game was electrifying. This was my first Metroid game, but I had spent pretty much my whole life hearing amazing things about this series. Those reviews claimed that Metroid Prime seemed as though it was at least a generation ahead of its time. As I finally stepped into the role of Samus Aran for the first time, I was hyped. I ended up putting more time into Animal Crossing. Yep. But I kept hearing that this was one of the best games ever made, so I was sure I was just missing something. I got it for Christmas the next year, and the same thing happened. Years later, I got the Trilogy version on Wii. It had these pointer controls that replicated the precision of a mouse and keyboard, which is normally the only way I can really get into FPS games, and for a while I felt like I was finally into Metroid Prime. But no, eventually, the same thing happened again. No matter how many times I'd try to pick it up over the years, I would always just lose interest and stop playing. This puts me into a bit of an awkward position. To be honest, I'm kind of nervous. I know a ton of you guys found me because of Metroid. I know you are probably huge Metroid fans, and yet, I really didn't care for one of the most beloved games in the series, at least when I first played it, but that was 14 years ago. Maybe now that I've become a fan of the 2D games, I'll find more to appreciate, because I did absolutely love that series. And to tell you the truth, I am even more hyped to play Prime now than I was the first time. But I do want to give myself the best possible shot at finding a lot to love about this game, and I know what I like, so I'll be playing the Trilogy version, but with mouse and keyboard controls via Dolphin. It took a little tweaking, but but the entire game did control just fine like this. And I will be getting into a few of the differences between this and the GameCube original, but the important thing is, for a standard playthrough, Prime is Prime regardless of how you play it. This is my ideal, and heading in, I was nothing but optimistic that I would finally fall in love with Metroid Prime. Once more under the breach, let's get critiquing. In decades past, a deeply spiritual group of Chozo swore off the technology their species had become so dependent on and built a natural refuge on a planet called Talon 4. But the Chozo hippies were forced out of their sanctuary when a meteor impacted the planet, and in the aftermath, strange elements poisoned and mutated the flora and fauna. Years later, following their humiliating defeat by a lone warrior on Zebes, the space pirates happened upon Talon 4. They realized the potential of this energy, which they called Phazon, and they set up mining operations and laboratories throughout the planet. So the space pirates were intentionally mutating life forms with Phazon, some of which ended up in orbit on board a frigate ship above the planet. Seems solid enough. What could go wrong with that? Oh, who could have seen that coming? Yes, the space pirates are once again hoist by their own petard, as Samus Aran responds to a distress signal from their ship. Oh man, this intro. God, I can only imagine how it felt if you'd been waiting for 8 years. It's only been a couple of months since I finished the 2D series, but God, this build-up, the camera cuts, that music! Yeah, it's still getting me. Retro Studios didn't just shoehorn Metroid into an FPS. It would have been all too easy to make the player feel like a floating gun, but Samus is anchored in this world. That signature floaty jump makes more sense than ever when you're jumping around in 3D. Her movement speed is a lot slower, which, you know, disappoints me, but a speedy pace wasn't at all what Retro set out to do. True to Nintendo's promise of a first-person adventure, twitchy aiming is never the focus, thanks to a simple and accurate lock-on feature that just snaps to enemies. The other reason aiming is automatic is to sort of free up the player to focus on maneuvering Samus in 3D space during combat. You can dodge around enemies you're locked onto. Narrowly avoiding a charging attack is always cool, but the mechanic still feels a little bit clunkier than it should be. The button you dodge with is the same one you jump with. I don't know, I guess I'd find combat more engaging without the lock-on, but more than anything, it was there to mitigate the need for dual analog aiming. See, the GameCube original had very, let's say, traditional first-person console controls. You move forward and backward and turn with the left stick, and have to hold R to aim up and down. This hasn't been the standard in a long time, but every console FPS I'd ever played before this controlled a whole lot like it. The important thing is, all of your weapons and abilities are designed with lock-on in mind. Typical video game firearms, especially back then, operated on a principle called hitscan. That means that as soon as you fire, the game performs an instant calculation to check whether or not you hit your target. It's simple math, easy on the CPU, and works well enough for something that flies as fast as a bullet. But Samus ain't firing bullets. Her attacks are all projectile-based, and they all have their own distinct cadence and rhythm, made manifest through exceptional sound design and effects. The crunchiest among them is that clear, consistent timing of a charge shot. I've always loved that warping effect, and when you release that blast, boom, you can almost feel the kickback. The interface, from the menu on down, is just slick in a way that Nintendo games usually aren't. All of the HUD elements are justified in-universe as part of Samus' literal heads-up display. This speaks to Metroid Prime's greatest ambition, to immerse the player in the role of Samus Aran. You see the edges of that helmet in your peripheral vision. Steam, slime, and water can coat the visor, and electromagnetic enemies interfere directly with your sensors. Occasionally, a blast of light will even illuminate Samus' visage against her visor. This even extends to her upgrades. Controlling Samus underwater without the gravity suit was always meant to feel a little frustrating, to make the moment you actually got it even sweeter. So, Prime's underwater sections feature terrible visibility in addition to the movement constraints. At least until you get that gravity suit, and things clear up. Prime is absolutely full of minor details like this, but they add up and they speak to just how much thought went into translating Metroid to this perspective. While there are a couple of different ways you'll find to see the world, the most critical one is the one you start with, the scan visor. The 2D series communicated a lot of functionality via these gamey blocks, but those would have killed believability in a 3D world. So instead, you now see these information nodes when you activate the scan visor. It's a fantastic tool for sussing out hints when you get stuck, and so it changes your relationship with the environment itself. Hidden items make this low, droning noise to clue you in now, and there's never a case where you'll need to just aimlessly bomb random walls anymore. No, instead you'll have to spam your whole arsenal at them because you can't remember the difference between cordite and vendesium. But maybe that's just me. I'm not as big a fan of how often the scan visor is used to activate mechanisms or disable force fields. Like, Samus has so many ways to do stuff like that, and scanning them is by far the least interesting. But for the most part, the scan visor was a worthy addition to the formula. However, I want to make a distinction between the scan visor, as it's used for environmental intel, and the logbook that it fills up, which allows Samus to gather information on the flora, fauna, and hazards of Talon 4. My problem is not believability. This thing feels right at home in universe, even if it sometimes seems like a bit of a stretch that it could intuit things so relevant to Samus's specific situation. But no, my real problem is just how harshly it pulls me out of the gameplay. One of my favorite things about the 2D Metroids was their approach to storytelling. The way they would convey not just important beats, but their backstory and lore via nothing but subtext. And don't get me wrong, Prime is still doing some of that, but I'm sorry, I just don't find it interesting to stop what I'm doing in a video game, point my reticle at a node, wait for a loading bar to fill up, and have the plot explained to me. Delivered in this way, it feels way too much like supplementary material. It's the kind of thing I'd rather delve into when I'm not playing the game. The logbook's at its best when you use it to scan enemies and pick up info on their weak points. But even then, it'd be a lot more fun and immersive if I could use design clues to intuit those strategies, instead of just being told, "Okay, you scan this thing, so you'll auto-lock here now." Situations where you need the scan visor are always well conveyed thanks to those differently colored nodes, but I kinda wish they'd taken it a step further and just use different symbols to convey environmental info without needing a scan. I mean, sometimes the simpler solution is better. Just show me a picture of a missile. Fortunately, filling up the logbook is optional. Well, for the most part. Unfortunately, I didn't see it that way when I was first playing Prime. I've never been a completionist, but I didn't really understand that about myself at the time. I went into it with this mentality that I might miss something, and I'm sure that trying to scan everything was at least partly to blame for why I ran out of steam so early back then. But hey, if this is what you want out of Metroid, I fully acknowledge that the extensive amount of prose in the logbook allows the lore to be a lot richer than it ever could have been otherwise. I'm just glad it's optional. The Morph Ball has been reimagined so perfectly, it feels like becoming small and round was made for 3D. It's intuitive just the way you move it. Unlike the 2D games, it holds momentum and reacts to slopes now. You know, I feel like there's some other series that, like, shied away from realistic pinball physics when it made the jump to 3D. Weird. Whatever I'm thinking of, it's probably because back in this era, pre-made physics engines weren't really a thing yet. Which makes it all the more impressive that Retro made it work. I always got a kick out of the fact that these technology-averse Chozo were apparently big Tony Hawk fans. The abundance of half-pipes is the most 2002 thing about Prime. Unlike Super Metroid, Samus's arm cannon upgrades no longer stack. Instead, they're held as separate modes. This could have gone horribly wrong if you still had to screw around in the menu to swap weapons, but this was a new era, and we developed a little something called real-time weapon change. Each beam has a much more distinct set of characteristics and abilities, and so each one is integrated into combat strategy and puzzle solving alike. But since the Wiimote lacks a few buttons compared to the GameCube pad, your real-time weapon and visor changes aren't nearly as snappy in the Trilogy version. Instead of just flicking the C-stick, you have to select an icon. I can't fault the game for that, and it still works, but it made what might have been a nitpick on the GameCube into a genuine frustrating issue for me. The Metroid series has always had these missile doors, and so does Prime. But Prime also features a bunch of doors that can only be opened with a specific beam. That's fine, but I really wish they'd made them more like those missile doors, and let you open them with any weapon once you blast them open once. The Space Pirate Station serves as a tutorial area. I have always loved how capable and varied your arsenal is right from the start. It's a linear shot toward the heart of the station, and the moment-to-moment gameplay beats feel like something out of Half-Life, polished and orchestrated with the player in mind. Now, Prime takes a lot of cues from Super Metroid, especially early on. A space colony, a Ridley encounter, an explosive escape followed by a rain-soaked arrival on a planet, an unsettling plant boss. But where I eventually got a little frazzled by the 2D series repeating itself, the very advent of 3D invigorates these sequences, and Retro took great pains to use those advances to make those nostalgic elements pop. Like in this escape, you're not just traversing the same rooms you already did, you're winding your way through the inner workings of the colony, and the rooms you do revisit show structural changes. It's frantic and exciting and immersive to a degree that a 2D game never could be. Then this happens. Yes, right after so expertly introducing all those cool abilities to you, a minor explosion somehow butchers Samus's power suit, leaving you with no morph ball, no charge beam, nothing except this spammy pea shooter.
How retro of you, Retro.
This is the point where Prime stops so directly guiding the player, strips away most of your power, maroons you on a non-linear world, and starts, you know, being a Metroid game. And this right here, is when I stopped playing Metroid Prime in 2002. I finally understand why. The prologue made such a perfect first impression. It's linear and exciting, full of awesome set pieces and fun abilities. Then all of a sudden, the game takes all of that away, plucks you out of that gripping sci-fi setting, and expects you to wander around these boring brown ruins with no particular objective. It went from being an action game to a Metroid game. And it was 100% intentional. The contrast of all this action with the somber ruins of the Chozo is fantastic, but I had no context for it back then. I didn't know who the Chozo were, I didn't care who Ridley was, I didn't know that by the end of that very first section, you'd regain almost every one of those abilities. This prologue gets so much praise, and most of it is well earned. But here's my critique. The intro failed to convey to me what a Metroid game was or how it worked. So when Prime flipped the switch on me and asked me to explore, I didn't just get lost, I lost interest. I got bored and I decided to go collect NES games instead. What I missed out on was a game full of contrasting elements. The daunting pressure of the Magmoor Caverns, and the crisp tundra of the Findrana Drifts, the natural beauty of the overworld, and the mechanical precision of the Space Pirate Labs. The spectacle of the boss battles, and the tragedy of Talon 4. One of the scan nodes in those labs notes that Phazon will kill all life on Talon 4 within 25 years, and that somber ambience of a world hanging on by a thread is exactly how it feels. Metroid Prime, quite frankly, realizes and articulates its world better than any game ever had before. And finally, getting to play through it now, there has been so much more that I missed out on. There have been times throughout this adventure when I have adored Metroid Prime, when it's all felt like exactly what I expect and want out of a 3D Metroid. But there have been way too many times when it hasn't. Let me see if I can show you what I mean. I discover this awesome underwater section in the Talon overworld, only to be told that I had to turn around, go all the way across the map back to the Findrana Drifts, go through its water section to get the gravity suit, and then do I get to keep going? Do these two areas maybe link together? Nope, I just had to go all the way back again. This is not an isolated incident. The entire game is set up like this. You'll be in the drifts and you'll find the speedball and the game will be like, hey, there's a half pipe you could use way back here. Is there an elevator directly connecting to that place? Nope. You just have to push through Magmoor, get back to the overworld, get the space jump, traverse back through the ruins, back through Magmoor, back to the drifts, and now, you can jump up here and see something new. The 2D games kept this to a minimum for the most part. You'd find the gravity suit, then you'd proceed, if you chose to, into a larger water section. Even when they did want you to zigzag between areas to get power-ups, there was often a way around it. Even when there wasn't, it certainly never took this long to get where you were going. Unless, of course, you chose to take that time to explore. But Prime makes you meander back and forth through the world so much, it has to be an intentional design choice. Where Prime has an unprecedented amount of cohesion in its setting and themes, its approach to progression lacks cohesion. Wildlife on Talon 4 is way more aggressive than the 2D games, and while in-universe we can justify that as an effect of the Phazon, the game also needs to delay a player long enough for the next room to load. On the one hand, it's really impressive that the game never cuts to a loading screen, but getting ambushed yet again on your dozenth time through the same hallway makes me wonder if it was worth it. Eventually, I just started ignoring fights, tanking hits, and waiting for the doors to load. When the player is incentivized to just ignore aggressive enemies like this, something's gone wrong. By the time Prime sent me on a half-hour romp down the Phazon mines with no save points, what should have been a tense, exciting difficulty spike only highlighted how repetitive and, quite frankly, boring the combat had become. Now let me be clear, the puzzles were wonderful! Excellent use of mechanisms in 3D space. The upgrades were fun too. I had no idea this game even had power bombs, but I'd done it so much that the combat had become a chore. Oh look, it's another group of space pirates that glow purple. Wow, the wave beam killed them. How about that? When I finally reached the bottom of those mines, I found an Omega Pirate, who was finally like a proper challenge with a cool gimmick. I had to figure out to blast his armor off and then use audio cues or the X-ray visor to suss out where he was cloaked. So when he finally went down, it actually felt like I had accomplished something. He collapses on Samus, and her suit gets corrupted with Phazon. It warps the very air around it, and we're gonna take it down into that impact crater and finally find out what went wrong on Talon 4. This is the climax! This is the end! This is what it's all been building toward! No, it's not! Instead, the game is like, hey, go wander around some more and, like, pick up all 12 of these symbols, and then we'll let you in. Yes, you have to pick up all of the Chozo artifacts. Now, you can scan these statues outside the crater to get pretty obvious hints as to where they're hidden, but they're scattered throughout the entire map. Now you might say, ah, but you could scan those hints right near the start of the game, and then look for them as you go. Well, okay, but most of them require items that you don't even get until the late game. There's usually nothing even special about the way they're hidden either. Not any more than the standard missile upgrades. They don't even make sense within the lore. If the Chozo sealed away whatever's down here with these 12 keys before they left, then how did they hide them inside of the mines that the space pirates built? Make no mistake, padding is all this is, and it padded my playtime by more than 2 hours. It is such a blatant fetch quest, tacked on and incredibly tedious. If they were that committed to doing this, okay, but don't require it. Maybe instead of unlocking the impact crater, collecting the artifacts could have made the final boss easier, or given you an extra upgrade. The point is, it's important to give the player that choice between progression and exploration. But that fantastic Omega Pirate fight, followed immediately by that awful artifact quest, it's kind of a microcosm of how I felt the whole game. Like, I didn't get a choice. A really fun and interesting new area would be revealed, and I'd press in there and find an awesome new power-up, only to be told that I'd need to once again trek across the entire world in order to actually put it to use. Something as simple as making all the elevators connect to a central hub could have saved a lot of this. And look, I recognize that backtracking is part of the formula, and I don't mind it when it's done well, like when it's been half the game since you've been through an area, and you've got tons of new abilities to put to use. But the way Prime does it is just overbearing. If they'd cut down all the forced zigzagging, the slower pace of the gameplay wouldn't have had the chance to wear on me so bad. But after a while, every time I'd shut the game off, I just felt drained, like I'd been playing it for hours when less than one had really passed. I didn't fully understand why until I went back and played a 2D Metroid game. There, defeating enemies came down to your reflexes. You as a player grew more skillful alongside Samus' own powers and abilities. In Prime, instead of becoming stronger, you get more options. It's more about strategy, knowing which weapon and visor to equip. But it's not freaking interesting because you fight the same spongy enemies with the same obvious solutions over and over! Aside from Super, I had never beaten any of the 2D games, but none of them took me more than about 4 hours on my first playthrough. In Prime, it took me half that time just to find all the artifacts. I hate feeling like this. I wanted real bad to love it, and I want to emphasize, I did find plenty to love about it. I love the music, which strikes this great, almost David Wise-like balance between ambience and melody. I love all those little details in the design, the world building, the confidence with which Retro took this franchise and brought it seemingly into the future. I love how much more developed and animated the space pirates are. By the way, those idiots are growing Metroids and injecting them with Phazon. What could possibly go wrong? I love how Prime takes place after the original Metroid, but before its sequel. In fact, the whole trilogy fits here, and it's such a bold move that could potentially lend so much more context to the entire series. I love how much more integrated into the world the puzzles are, and how fantastically they take advantage of 3D space. I especially love the hint system. I need it in a game like this. But I can't help but think that a more sensible approach to progression wouldn't have needed one, and the previous game in this very series is evidence of it. I love what happens when you finally return all those artifacts and Ridley ambushes Samus. Just seeing him, just hearing that theme got my adrenaline pumping. He starts breaking all the stupid artifact statues and instantly becomes my new favorite character. Yeah! Ridley for Smash Brothers! Ah, the fight is fantastic too, just full of awesome attacks and dodging and timing our hits and yes! Even then, like most things in Prime, it overstays its welcome. Look, if a player has figured out how to effectively counter a boss's attack pattern, it's time for a new one. Stop testing me on these same things over and over. I love the game's namesake, the final boss, Metroid Prime. This is what has been producing all that Phazon. The first part of the fight is about using the beam combo it's weak to, but it's a lot more dynamic than the static enemies, since Prime can switch between them, barraging you with so many different attacks. I pursued it deeper and deeper underground as the tension built, and when I finally busted its exoskeleton, the core was revealed. Now, instead of swapping beams, I was swapping visors to find it. The corrupted power suit can change into a hyper mode when Samus stands in pure Phazon, which invites a final comparison to Super Metroid, giving you an ultra-powerful weapon in the final boss fight. But as usual, Prime takes the idea from the series past, but uses player expectations to surprise you. My jaw dropped when I saw just how little damage I was doing. As Metroid Prime and I whittled away at each other's health, it was intense. I really thought I might lose this one, but I didn't. Metroid Prime was taken down. I literally fist-pumped when I saw those words. Epic escape scene, here we go. Or, I'll just appear back outside and watch the ending. That's fine. There is a game within Metroid Prime that I really enjoyed, but for every interesting new area I got to explore, for every exciting new enemy, for every power-up I found, for every solitary second that I got to enjoy playing it, I had to navigate dozens of rooms I've already seen and blow away the same boring enemies hundreds of times. I don't want to understate this. The backtracking, the lack of cohesion to player progression, ruined Metroid Prime for me. I enjoyed every single 2D Metroid, even the first one, substantially more than I enjoyed this one. I had hoped that being a fan of those 2D games would make a difference, and it did. But instead of letting me enjoy it more, it gave me something similar that I liked better to compare to. For the first time, the ending you get is not dependent on how quickly you beat the game. No, it's dependent on how many items you found, and how much of that logbook you filled up. And that kinda says it all. When the trilogy version came out, they bumped the default difficulty way down without being clear that they even did that. The original game's difficulty was bizarrely called Veteran, instead of, I don't know, original? What really kills it is that Trilogy fixes a lot of the sequence-breaking tricks that had been discovered on the GameCube. They didn't want you to think outside the box and accidentally do something dangerous outside the boundaries of the developer's intent. The world feels more real, sure, but your progression through it is so much more structured. Decisions like this are antithetical to what I've come to love about Metroid. For all these reasons, Metroid Prime was the worst possible introduction I could have had to this series. It avoided or obfuscated the very elements that could have, and eventually did, make me a fan of Metroid. So, did Retro Studios fail? Are all the people who adore this game just blinded by nostalgia? Is Metroid Prime nothing more than an overrated insult to game design in general and to me personally? Is this, as it turns out, just not a real Metroid game? No. What Metroid Prime is a Metroid game that's not for me. And aside from that artifact quest, Retro Studios miraculously made the right call in nearly every single decision they made. Also, calling a game overrated is stupid. Stop it. The 2D Metroids were made at the pinnacle of an era before immersion as a goal of design was technically feasible. Storytelling could only be done via text boxes or subtext. So unless it was like an RPG or a visual novel, some kind of skill-based gameplay was almost always the core focus of the design because it had to be. I've often heard it said that Metroid Prime is, and I quote, basically Super Metroid but in 3D. Now more than ever, I just have to say, what? No it isn't. It takes a lot of inspiration from Super, certainly, but the focus on what it sets out to achieve is very different. I'm sure some people enjoy both games for similar reasons, but, well, that kind of brings us full circle. What is Metroid? The truth is, that's a real subjective question with no right answer. Whatever you say, what you're really answering is a different question. Why are you a fan of this series? And your answer to that may reveal a whole lot about why you're a gamer in the first place. I answered that one for myself a long time ago. Video games are about gameplay, first and foremost. Thus, you can choose to become more skillful. Your skill will be rewarded. For me, a video game can certainly be about storytelling, world building, and immersion, and I appreciated all of those elements in 2D Metroid, but I only got to appreciate them because the moment-to-moment gameplay stayed engaging. The industry had evolved in 8 years. By 2002, games could be more than just games. They could be experiences. If you do get immersed in the world of Talon 4, you'll revel in the chance to uncover everything that you can. If it were designed and paced more like Super Metroid, then all the work that went into this world would have had less chance to shine. More significantly, the game would have been a lot shorter. Where replayability was often the focus in 1994, a Metroid Prime that only took 4 hours to beat would have been raked over the coals by 2002. What I see as padding, I understand that Prime's fans see as more of an opportunity to spend time here, immersed in the role of Samus. This commitment to immersion is exactly what set Metroid Prime apart from other games at the time, and sets it apart even now from the gameplay centrism that Nintendo often prioritizes. It had its finger on the pulse of where AAA game development was going. You know, it's funny. Things might have been a lot different if I'd played Metroid Fusion first. Aside from all the unskippable story scenes, it went in the opposite direction of Prime, and I think it did so on purpose. Where Prime catered toward adventurers and completionists, Fusion was a much more linear, challenging, action-focused game that got to be that way because it dialed back on the esoteric stuff. There's an alternate universe out there where I spent the last 15 years as a fan of this series, instead of just the last few months. But in this timeline, I spent all those years thinking that I wouldn't be a fan of Metroid, judging the series based on what I gleaned here, when in truth, I just wouldn't be a fan of Metroid Prime. But I can still respect it. The cohesion, the continuity, the tone that set the Metroid franchise apart from other games in previous generations were so spectacularly realized. It deserves every accolade it's ever gotten for brazenly reimagining the formula without losing the soul of Metroid. So many people doubted them. But if the true ending is anything to go by, Retro Studios never doubted themselves. The return of Samus was made manifest, and the explosive success of Metroid Prime would catapult the franchise into its golden age. The Geek Critique for that game, Metroid Prime 2, is available right now for anyone who supports this channel on Patreon, and it'll be up on YouTube next week. I've also got a Patreon-exclusive bonus episode for the game that ended that golden age, Metroid Other M. Thanks for watching, see you next week, and until then, you keep geeking, I'll keep critiquing.